Hello everyone. So in this video, we would be exploring about Elastic Beanstalk of AWS, how we can use it. Before starting, this video is basically a crash course of Elastic Beanstalk. We are not going in deep. We are not going to deep dive into it. So if you guys are preparing for certification like me, or if you guys are in a hurry to study only about the key points of Elastic Beanstalk, then this video is the ideal video for you guys. So starting with Elastic Beanstalk is a service which can be used to create applications with few clicks or by uploading direct zip file if we have the package handy with us. So the advantage of Elastic Beanstalk is that we do not have to go and configure and set up the services like EC2 for using instance on cloud, or for we do not have to configure our RDS or any relational databases like Postgres. We can do that by going to our Elastic Beanstalk and do that with few clicks only. It is one stop place where we can manage all our services, and we can have multiple environments for our application. So how can we create? I'll show you guys. We just have to go and search Elastic Beanstalks. I'll go and I have searched. We have to click on create new environment, and let's first Elastic Beanstalk create. First we have to create application. I have already created, so I'll show you guys demo. Then we have to choose the core language. I'm going with the PHP one, and if we have the code handy with us, we can upload it, the zip file, or we can upload the S3 URL if we have the package uploaded to S3. So I'm going with the sample application. So on clicking on this create application button, it actually creates the application. Takes a lot, quite a few minutes of time. So for saving that amount of time, I have created an application already with these many steps only. I'm using simple application for this demo. So I've created an application called Drupal Hex with that simple application of PHP. So I'm using PHP 7.4. So after installing after clicking on this create application button, it shows us a console with all the events like this, as in what is happening. And after successful launching the environment, it redirects us to this page, and we can use this DNS to check with the environment or the application. So inside our application, we can have multiple environments. How we can have multiple environments? We can click on the environment, or we can create new environment. So that way we can create new environments. Like, we can create dev environment for our application, we can create production environment for our application. So that is how we deploy our applications using Elastic Beanstalk, or we do not have to be bothered about EC2 instances, configuring them separately, configuring our databases separately, load balancers separately. So with the help of Elastic Beanstalk, we can have all this being configured at one place only. So this is one stop for a lot of services. So this is what Elastic Beanstalk is. So coming on to the key points of the Elastic Beanstalk, if you guys are preparing for Elastic Beanstalk or sorry certification like me, so these are the key points. So in Elastic Beanstalk there are multiple deployment types which we can use based on our requirement to deploy our application. So I would be explaining one by one about each of the deployment type. So I'll start with the all at once deployment option. So all at once deployment option, what it does, so suppose we have code running at version 1, so all at once what it does, it creates new instances all and deploy them all at once with the new code or with the new version. So in this way we can see we are at version 1, we stop our instances, then we deploy it to version 2. In this way this deployment all at once is fast, but this deployment is fast, but we have downtime because we face a time where we are not running on any version or all our versions are at stopped stage. So there is downtime, and this type of deployment called as all at once is very good if we have application where we are frequently deploying changes and we do not bother about the downtime. So it is very good for such type of applications as it is very quick. So next one is the rolling type. So rolling type of deployment is where we have to deploy our code. So suppose the current version is running on version 1 and we have to deploy it to version number 2. So what happens here, at first step it will stop certain batch. This batch we can define, this batch is configurable, so this batch we can define. So at first step it stops that batch of instances, and then at next step it deploys the new version or code at those for those batches. So here it is deploying version 2 for 2 instances, and version 1 is running on 2 other instances. So we are at this place, the application is running on both the version 1 and version 2 simultaneously. So version 2 at next step our version 1 gets terminated. The application, the half of the batch is running on version 2, but the rest of the batch is stopped, and at next step the rest of the batch gets deployed with version 2. So now at last step we have all the instances of our applications are running with the new version called version 2. This deployment is a long deployment. There is no additional cost as we are not using more instances for deploying our application. There comes a time where we have both the versions running on our application simultaneously, and there's one thing which I have already explained, that we can define the batch size. So this is rolling. And coming on to the REST3 deployment type. So rolling, the third one is rolling with additional batches. So in this deployment, if you guys see from the diagram, at first step the version 1, the application is running on version 1. At second step we can configure a, like in the rolling deployment, we can configure a batch size. So the instances with that best inside that best sites get deployed with the new version at September 2. So we are here, we can see version 2 and version 2 for two instances running on two instances, and version 1 is running on four instances. At the next step, the version 1 for two instances gets stopped. Even now our application is supporting four instances. Two of them are supporting running on version 1 and two of them are running on version 2. At the next step, our application deploys version 2 on the instances which were stopped earlier, and also stops the other two instances. On this step as well, our application is running on version 2 on four instances, but two instances are at stopped stage. At next stage, our application gets deployed with version 2 on the instances which were stopped at the earlier stage. So at this stage, the application is running with six instances running on version 2. At the next step, the batch size, the additional batches which we use for deployment gets terminated, and the application runs on the number of instances which were there in the at the initial step. This is again long deployment, and there comes a time where we are running on two versions, both the versions simultaneously. This type of deployment is very good for production, as it involves very less downtime. And again, we can configure the bucket size, and there is extra cost. So extra cost is there, as we are using additional batches for our deployment, so additional cost is there for this type of deployment. The next one is immutable. Inside immutable, instead of new instances, we go with having a temporary auto scaling group inside this. So for this deployment, we have a temporary auto scaling group with the same instances running on the new code called as version 2. So in the next step, what happens? So next step, what happens? The current ASG and the temp ASG with version 2 gets merged. So at the third step, we run both the versions. And at the fourth step, the temporary ESG, instances running on version 1 gets terminated, and we end up with instances running on V2 version. This involves high cost, as we are making use of temporary ESG, but it has zero downtime. Also, it is the longest deployment. And it is very good for production, as we can roll back very quickly, as it is involving temporary ASG. So if we face any challenge, we can go back to the current ASG. So it involves rollback, which is very quick. So this is a good option for production. The last type of deployment is blue green deployment. So inside this deployment, there is no direct way of doing this deployment. So inside this deployment, we create a new environment separately, and then with the help of route 53's weighted policy, we divert a certain portion of our traffic to version 1 and certain portion, say about 10% of our traffic to version 2, which is hosted on new environment we have created. Upon successful testing, we can redirect the 100% traffic with the help of beanstalk swapping of URLs. So this is again costly, but it is very quick to roll back, and it is very good as testing can be done independently on the new version of the code. So this is all about the deployment. The other thing about the Elastic Beanstalk is that there is a concept called Elastic Beanstalk lifecycle policy. We can use this policy to define certain rules. Based on those rules, we can have our versions deleted automatically. Why we need to do it? Because we have a limitation of 1,000 versions per application in AWS. So for keeping a track on that, we can have a life policy defined in our Elastic Beanstalk. In that way, the older versions which are no longer in use or which we do not want can be deleted automatically after a certain time. So the next topic is Elastic Beanstalk extension. So this is, as I've shown in the earlier step, that we can upload our packages if we have. Then the packages, we bind those packages in zip file, and we can upload them to S3. So what happens, we should upload our resources, whatever we want, like load balancer, EC2, or databases, or whatever we want for our application. We should bind them in zip file and have them inside the EB extensions directory, and also the resources which we want for our application should, and the configuration for those resources should be in a file which should end with extension.config. And one more thing, upon deleting the extension, all our resources gets deleted. So this is all about the Elastic Beanstalk extensions. We have one more feature called as Beanstalk cloning. So if we want one more environment with the same configuration, we can make use of this feature called Elastic Beanstalk cloning. The other thing which I wanted to talk about is Beanstalk migration. So for doing Beanstalk migration, we cannot make use of cloning, because it would, so first of all, suppose consider a scenario where I want to upgrade my application running on certain running with Classic Load Balancer, and I want to migrate it to Application Load Balancer. So for doing that, we can perform migration, and for doing this, we cannot make the use of cloning feature, because cloning will clone the environment to new environment with exact same features or configuration, that is the Classic Load Balancer. So for doing, we cannot make use of cloning feature. So for doing migration, first we have to create a new environment with whatever the configuration we want, which is Application Load Balancer, and then make use of route 53 CNAME CNAME to route redirect the traffic to this new environment. So this is how we do migration. So this is all about the Elastic Beanstalk, or a crash course, I would say. So I hope it would help you in some way. Thank you.